Hey listeners, welcome back to another out-of-world new story with Revolving Time. Time is a fascinating and universal concept that affects every aspect of our lives. Uncover the hidden secrets and truths. I hope you've all enjoying this long story. Okay, let's go on to story. This is the story of how a simple gift bought for fun destroyed my happy marriage, my family, and my happy life. I suppose I better introduce myself. I'm Darren, 54, married for 28 years to Caroline, 55. When I met Caroline, I was 24, already teaching art at the local high school. No, we're not American. We live on the Yorkshire coast in the north of England. I remember the first time I saw her. She had this short skirt on, and I remember thinking I never realized I was a leg man. She had a beautiful pair of legs, and although only a B-cup, she had this way of arching her back to look very buxom. She was bubbly and giggly, and I thought that she was the most beautiful thing I'd ever seen. She never believed that she was beautiful, though. I did and planned to spend the rest of my life making her feel beautiful. She just couldn't see what I saw. She saw a round chubby face and a nose that was a little larger than it perhaps should have been. I saw her beautiful blue eyes that turned green when she cried at soppy films. I saw her beautiful smile and cupid bow lips. I saw perfection. Me, well, I'm tall, 6 foot and tower over Kaz's 5 foot. I have dark hair, now streaked with gray, green eyes, and I'm still nice looking, so I'm told. Kaz doesn't give out a lot of compliments. She reckons I know I still look good. When we first met, she called me Clarky, as she said I looked just like Clark Kent with my dark hair and glasses. It took me a while to convince her to go out with me. I always remind her that I've loved her longer than she has loved me. When we finally did get together, though, it was love. We were engaged after 3 months. Madness, I know. We were married the following year, but I never had those pre-wedding jitters. I simply adored her. Simple as that. She wasn't perfect, but then neither was I. She had a terrible temper and could be selfish, but she was perfect for me. 28 years later, we were celebrating our son Scott's 21st birthday. We struggled a bit to have him. It took us years, and we never managed to have any more. This was something that we still found painful. We couldn't complain, though, as some people are never blessed, and our Scott was a real blessing. He was a son that any man could be proud of. He was the type of child you could also take anywhere. Now, as an adult, he would talk to anyone, make them feel at ease, and had a funny, engaging personality. From babies to old folk, our Scott charmed them all. Scott and I were very close and shared the same sense of humor. He would often say what I was about to say before I had chance to say too. We spent a lot of time together, and he called me his buddy as well as his dad. I know that you have to be your child's parent, not their friend, but I hope I have done both. How would I not want a kid as brilliant as him to be my pal? We might be very similar in personality, but we didn't look alike at all. All fathers want their children to look like them. I think it is some Neanderthal thing, but Scott didn't. Kaz's side of the family had exceptionally strong genes. They all looked alike. Kaz and her cousins looked more like siblings. Scott looked like his mom, her dad, and everyone else in her family. When we looked after Kaz's sister's children, our nephews, we could never convince strangers that the three cousins weren't brothers and that Kaz wasn't mom to all three. We loved those times with the nephews, as it gave us a glimpse into what life might have been like with a larger family. Oh well, a larger family was not to be. We were very lucky. We had no real money worries. We loved spending time together. Kaz and I could never understand those couples who spent their weekends apart. We used to watch our neighbors taking it in turns to go out with friends whilst the other took a turn to look after the children. We loved spending our time together. We were that sort of couple. I still love her as much as I ever had and found her very attractive. She certainly didn't look her age. We both looked like a couple in our 40s rather than 50s. This was helped by Kaz's hair that still didn't have any gray in it. This was another family trait, as her dad had been just the same. Their hair faded to a softer shade rather than going gray or white. The only blot on our marriage in recent years had been a somewhat dead bedroom. We had always had a very active sex life. Kaz had only had one boyfriend before me, and though not a virgin when we met, was quite inexperienced. I, however, had been rather busy at university, and Kaz was very receptive and surprised at my sharing of skills. One of my favorite things sexually is to perform oral sex. I love it. It's my kink, I suppose, being a cunning linguist. We never made love without Kaz coming on my tongue, ever. I was amazed that she'd never done that with her previous boyfriend. Apparently, he thought it was dirty. I think it's the most wonderful thing a man can do for women, and any man who doesn't is rather questionable. In recent years, since Kaz had hit the menopause, she'd lost all interest in sex. Penetration was painful, and she complained about my girth. I didn't want to hurt her, so I continued to perform oral on her instead. We both enjoyed that, but it was rarely reciprocated. However, soon any sexual contact became a rarity. This upset me greatly and did cause some frustrations in our marriage. I suppose it made me feel less of a man and less attractive too. Kaz would just display her legendary temper whenever I tried to broach the subject. I found it so difficult because not only did I still find her so attractive, and I had still had a rather teenage libido too. So, at 54 I was still taking myself in hand, so to speak, on a daily basis. Apparently it is essential for a healthy prostate. Anyway, I loved her so much, it was something that I reluctantly learned to live with. It hurt, but I wasn't going to step outside the marriage. Fidelity and trust was all important to me. I had an older colleague once, Trevor. He was in his late 50s at the time and recently divorced. He got very drunk at a staff do and I was nominated to see him home. Home was now a rather bare little flat and over a coffee he told me his story. He was very much in love with his wife, but when he started to suffer from some erectile dysfunction, she decided to fulfill her needs elsewhere. She looked at it as entirely separate from their loving marriage and seemed beyond shocked that Trevor had divorced her. Trevor's ex-wife now lived alone in another flat, still shocked that her lack of loyalty to her husband could result in her new life. The sad thing was a simple change of blood pressure medication later solved all Trevor's problems in that department. Too late for his first marriage, but just in time for his second that provided him with a very happy retirement. I could never be unfaithful to Kaz just to fulfill my sexual needs. My beautiful Kaz had given me a wonderful son, home and memories. I owed it to her to deal with this new stage in our lives in a loving way. One of the things that Scott and I shared together was a love of genealogy. We were very excited to find that we were related to royalty. Yes, my 30th great-grandfather was a king. Yes, I know, along with many thousands of others, but still exciting. We ended up with thousands of names on our family tree. Kaz wasn't interested. She said it was just a list of dead people. We tried to interest her, but she really wasn't bothered. When I got my DNA kit a few years ago, I offered to get her one, but she had one of her legendary tantrums. She was very much against it, saying they would know all about me. I wasn't quite sure who this big brother like they was and what they intended to do with those information about a rather ordinary secondary school teacher. Anyway, I let it slide. It just became my thing and it was okay to have a separate interest, for once. Update. A few years later, Scott and I still occasionally dipped into the Ancestry website, particularly after an interesting message popped up. Our interest had lessened a little after we realized we weren't going to find any more illustrious relatives. Scott did like to check on my DNA matches from around the world that popped up often as more people joined. I suppose that it was my Irish ancestry that ensured matches across the globe. So many people had scattered after the potato famine. So, I decided that as an extra little present for Scott's 21st, I would get an Ancestry DNA testing kit. The fact that it was on special offer probably helped too. Being a bit busy in the lead up to his birthday, I ordered it a bit late. When it eventually came a few days after his birthday, we quickly completed it, and I posted it on my way to school. I didn't mention it to his mom as I knew her feelings on such things. Anyway, it was one of my things with Scott. I certainly didn't want her to start all the big brother type they stuff again. Who would be watching Scott now too? I realize that all you people out there have realized long ago what is about to happen next. Looks obvious, doesn't it? And you would be right. All I can say is that it wasn't obvious to me. In fact, when I came home one night a few days later to find my life as I knew it had ended, I couldn't have been more shocked. Kaz was crying on the settee in the conservatory, crying as though her heart was truly broken. My first thought was to wonder who had died. I rushed to her and held her in my arms. She couldn't speak for a while, so I just held her, begging her to tell me what had happened. She eventually managed to stutter that she had been talking out the recycling and seen the cardboard box the DNA testing kit came in. At this point, I started to feel a bit sick. This was a major overreaction, even for Kaz. I was starting to panic and I felt like my stomach had hit the floor. I could barely take it in when she said, "Scott's yours, Darren." "He is. You're his dad, but someone else got me pregnant. I did it for us, I swear." Silence seemed to surround me for a second until I found myself heaving. I rushed to the door of the conservatory and brought up the contents of my lunch all over the steps down into the garden. Kaz actually stroked my back as I was ill, soothing me, like she cared. Eventually, I calmed down enough to turn to her and I screamed at her. "For us. Yes, to make us a family," she said quietly. Then the old Kaz was back and she shouted back, "It had been so long, Darren." I knew that I couldn't talk calmly to her. I was just too angry, but I just couldn't walk away until I knew more. "You heard what the doctor said, Kaz. You heard him say that there was nothing wrong with either of us. No reason why we couldn't have a baby. My swimmers might not have been Olympic standard, but they were perfectly average and capable of getting the job done. There was nothing wrong with you either. I know that one of your ovaries wasn't firing on all cylinders, but the other one was fine. That's why they didn't intervene earlier. We just needed time." I was running out of time though, Darren. I wasn't all right. I kept thinking about what the doctor said about my ovary. I thought that if I got some stronger sperm, it would counteract my lowered fertility. So Clark Kent's sperm wasn't good enough for you, then? You decided that you needed Superman to do it with his superhuman sperm. So where did you find that then? She looked at me shocked. Where? I shouted. It was Angus, she said quietly. I don't actually remember leaving the house. I know logically that I had to walk through two rooms in the hallway to get out of the house, but I have no memory of it. What I do remember was that if I hadn't left at that point, I was capable of doing something that I might later regret. I roared out of the drive and eventually pulled up on a quiet bit of the promenade. Out of season, it was almost deserted. Angus, as in my best friend, our best man and the closest thing in the world I had to a brother. She might as well have stabbed me. Angus and I had been friends since we first met aged 18 at university. We were both doing art degrees. I took mine into teaching, but he moved into art restoration. Wherever we went at university, people assumed we were brothers rather than roommates. We were the same build and coloring, though my eyes were a paler green than his. He was an inch shorter than me in height. We shared a room, so I also knew that he was an inch or two shorter than me in other departments too. Why had I thought about that? Typical male. Now I took a small crumb of comfort from knowing that, I suppose. We were best mates, inseparable at uni. He was my best man and later I was his. Kaz and Angus didn't actually meet till a couple of weeks before the wedding, as he'd been living in France for a year working in a gallery and honing his restoration skills. Kaz laughed when she met him, saying how we must have come out of the same pod. He was excited when he came back a fortnight later for the wedding, as he had met Kate a few days before. She later became his wife. He had really fallen hard, a bit like I had for Kaz. See, I told you how alike we were. He was at home visiting his parents on the Lancashire coast, and he'd met Kate at their church. His parents and Kate were part of what I called a happy clappy born again type of church. He was a member, but he certainly didn't make an issue about it in the student union bar. He was a member of the Christian Union though, and I knew he was virgin and intended to stay that way until marriage. When he later married Kate, I know they were both virgins. I knew he was anxious about that on the morning of the wedding, so I tried to give him a pep talk. Anxious and a virgin does not make for a fulfilling wedding night, I would have imagined. Anyway, at the wedding, her family all assumed that I was his brother and not his three actual brothers that were there, as I looked most like him. I was an only child, so this link with Angus was very important to me. I treasured it. He really was the closest thing I had to a brother and had been my friend for 37 years. I loved him. Kate and Angus had gone on to have four children. Three girls, Rachel, Ruth, and Ryan, before we had Scott. They had their boy, Jake, 6 months after Scott was born. As an only child, I relished being Uncle Darren, both to them and to Kaz's two nephews. Although they lived on the opposite coast to us, it was only a few hours away, so we tended to visit them, as we only had one child to transport. Scott loved being part of this large family, and we got together for high days and holidays every other month or so. Jake and Scott were best pals too. They both loved anything to do with transport, a bit like myself. Angus wasn't interested in that, so I took the boys to lots of car museums, bus fairs, and classic car rallies. It was our thing. Angus and I talked weekly, later sending texts, and more recently daily jokes and memes that we'd found online. Kate was an odd one. I really liked her and I could always make her laugh, but I sometimes found her a little brittle and inflexible. Harry Potter and Halloween was banned because of their religious beliefs. She did insist that Angus became more involved with the church. I did sometimes think that she was a little harsh with Angus where the kids were concerned. At his 40th birthday, she really lost it with him before his party over something trivial. After the party, we actually came home a day early. I wanted to defend him, you see, but I knew better than to get between a husband and wife. She knew it had bothered me though, and said that she felt she could let rip on front of me because I knew what he was like. Everyone else always thinks that he is perfect, but only you and I know him, warts and all. As I sat in my car on my own, I realized that I didn't know my oldest friend at all. In fact, I didn't have an old friend. The two people I trusted most in the whole world had betrayed me, and I only had Scott left. But what if he didn't want me either? I texted Scott straight away. I needed to see him before he saw Kaz. I needed to tell him that whatever happened, he would always be my son to me, and nothing would ever change that. I could only trust that he would feel the same about me. We had managed to buy a few buy-to-let property, and he lived in one of those. He was worried when he first saw me approach his little flat and instantly said, "God, Dad, you look awful. Are you ill?" As he came forward to hug me, he pulled away. "Have you been sick? You stink. What's going on?" I repeated what had happened as best I could and told him that I always wanted to be his dad before I broke down in sobs. He got hold of my face like I was the child and he was the father and said, "You are the best dad, my only father. I don't even want to know who this other guy was. I don't need to know. He means nothing to me. He doesn't matter. I don't want to ever meet him." He must have seen me flinch at what he must have thought were reassuring words. I have already met him, haven't I, Dad? I can tell by your face. I could only nod. Who? Uncle Angus. I washed up as best I could. I needed to be strong for him now. I couldn't shake away the feeling that just a few hours ago, my life seemed almost perfect. Now it was all a lie. Every foundation that I based my life on had crumbled, except my love for Scott. After showering, I put on some of Scott's joggers and a t-shirt. They were a bit snug, but I knew he wouldn't mind. He returned less than an hour later. He was seething. He also had a small bag of my clothes. I've told her you're staying here tonight and she'd got till tea time tomorrow to pack her stuff. She can move in here and we will go home. Why should you not be in your own bed, just because she wanted to sample someone else's? I'm not leaving you on your own, Dad, and the way I feel about her at the moment. I doubt I will be speaking to her for a long time. What else did she say, son? She said that she loves you and we will get over this as a family. She's delusional, Dad. She's lost the plot. You do know that I can never forgive her, don't you? I don't care if it was just a one-off because she was feeling desperate. She deceived me and lied to me every day for over 20 years. I can't forgive that. You will need to talk to her yourself, Dad. Although I don't think that anything is going on now, from what she let slip, it was definitely more than a one-off. I've already given her the spare key, so you can just go home after school tomorrow as normal. I'll meet you there. You will be okay to go to work tomorrow, won't you? Probably not. But it's a training day before the half term, so I will have to manage. They are very awkward about you being ill or whatever on the day before we break up for the holidays. They think we're faking for cheap flights. Scott passed me the bag and said, Dad, I think I've got what you need in here. Anything else, just take mine. Mum was very reluctant to let me take anything, but I didn't give her much choice. I'm sorry I won't be here when you get up, Dad. I've got a very early start, but I'm only a phone call away. We'll get through this and I'll be with you every step of the way. I was so proud of this young man. I looked at him and said quietly, I'm meant to be supporting you, that's what my job is. Dad, you've looked after me always and now it's my turn to look after you. I won't lie, I'm shocked and very angry. The only difference is I haven't lost anything. I've still got you and Mum's there if I choose to accept her. That's my decision and I don't know what that will be yet. I haven't really lost anything. But you have. I promise you, you'll never lose me. See what I told you, how could you not love this kid? I actually managed to sleep a little, much to my surprise. I did hear Scott go out at about 4 a.m. I knew it would be early, but I didn't think it would be that early. I managed at school but only just. I wasn't really taking in anything from the training course, and when I was asked a question, I had to blag it. I got away with it, but my closest colleague Graham asked if I was okay during the tea break. I told him I thought I had a migraine and he agreed I wasn't looking well. We finished by 4 p.m. so I wandered round the nearest supermarket for a while. I didn't want to go home and find that Kaz was still there. At 5:15 p.m. I turned into the drive but found Kaz's car parked in her usual spot. Great. I nearly turned back round again and felt that fictitious migraine might soon become a reality. Well, I suppose I had to find out the truth, sooner or later. Best get it over with. Kaz greeted me with a smile. I didn't expect you to be here. I said quietly. I know what I promised Scott but I wanted, no needed, to talk to you first. Yeah, well, you've already proved that your promises don't mean much. Just let me explain and then I'll go to Scott's, I promise. I realize that you've had a dreadful shock, but I need to explain. Well, I want the full truth, Kaz. I can't promise that it will make any difference, but I promise you, if I find out you have left anything out, I won't ever speak to you again. Have you spoken to Angus? Kaz asked. Why would I want to speak to him? Well, I just wanted you to know that I haven't told him that you know. I wanted to speak to you first. Thank you, I'm sure putting me first for once was difficult for you. So the floor is yours. I'll try my best not to interrupt. Update 1. I'd got to have a child. All that crying every month. You held me and reassured me, but it wasn't enough. I was desperate to have a child. Angus was the perfect person, you see. He looked just like you, but that didn't matter in the end as Scott looks so much like my side. I couldn't take the risk, you see. He was so like you in looks and he'd already fathered 3 girls. Kate had told me that he only had to look at her and she was pregnant. So how exactly did you broach this subject with my best friend? Hi Angus, it seems your oldest and dearest pal isn't getting the job done when it comes to impregnating me. You are tried and tested in the baby-making department. Would you like a crack at it? Darren, no, it wasn't like that. He knew that you felt you were letting me down. He knew how much you were hurting. He only agreed to help us because of you. He just wanted to help. To help himself to my wife, you mean? No, it wasn't like that. He was only ever going to be a donor. The first time we met in a hotel, it certainly wasn't to be intimate in any way. We were going to use a turkey baster, that was the plan. He would go off to the bathroom and have a shower and do his thing. He said being in the shower would help. I would go to the door and he'd pass me his stuff and he promised to stay out of the room until I was decent. We would have seen less of each other's bodies than we have seen on the beach or at the pool numerous times before. It did feel strange through and very sterile. I started to doubt if this was the way I wanted to create a child for us. I stayed on the bed but I did slip my knickers off so I could do it as quickly as possible when he was ready. He couldn't do it though, it didn't work. He came out wrapped in a towel. He needed something to excite him. I just couldn't waste this opportunity to get pregnant. You must see that. No, I don't, Kaz, I really don't. So, I lifted my skirt and showed him. I'm so sorry but I needed it to work. He started to get hard, I could see it under the towel. I turned around and told him to put it in me. I thought that if we did it doggy style, and I couldn't see his face, I could pretend that it was you. So that would make it alright. But it wasn't alright, Darren. It was awful. Quite the worst sexual experience of my life. He was smaller than you, of course. He was useless. He just didn't seem to know what to do. How he fathered three children I couldn't fathom. He had nothing on you. After he came, he sat on the end of the bed and cried. I thought it was guilt about what we'd done. Guilt about you. I put my arm around him to tell him it was okay and he kissed my cheek and said, that was the best. I never knew that it could be like that. As good as that. Thank you. As he sobbed in my arms, this big strong man, so like you, I just couldn't believe it. He thought that was good. He was thanking me for the worst bit of copulation ever. I don't think that I've ever felt as sorry for anyone in my life. He had just risked his marriage, his family and your friendship to give us our family. I owed him, which was when I decided to thank him properly. I hadn't planned it, it just happened in the moment. It wasn't about you or me. It was something separate. I didn't love him or care about him like that. It was a mixture of being grateful and feeling overwhelmingly sorry for him. He had the family we wanted so desperately, but he didn't have a love like ours. He really had no idea. So now we've moved on to a pity fuck. I suppose you could say that if you were going to be coarse. I carried on cuddling him, rocking him, and his head dropped down to my chest. I lifted out a breast and I suckled him, Darren, like he was my baby. I was just comforting him, really, that was all. It was only then that I began to teach him about sex, just like you'd taught me. The only difference was that you'd taught me about making love. This was just sex, the mechanics of good sex. There is no love, I promise you. Yes, I did things for him that he'd never experienced with Kate and I took pleasure in his pleasure, like you've done so often with me. It wasn't about me though, it was about him. I never ever did anything for him that I didn't do with you. How reassuring. I always made sure of it. Whenever we met, I came home and made love to you. I couldn't bear the thought that you were missing out on anything. You always had the same on those days. But I didn't have the same, did I? I had sloppy seconds. He still had a faithful wife and I had someone else's whore. I stopped as an awful thought occurred to me. You let me eat you out, knowing that you were filled with his stuff. Darren, it wasn't like that. I was giving myself back to you, back to my husband, by feeding me your lover's spunk. I made it to the sink this time as I began to heave. As I was trying to get myself together, I splashed some cold water on my face and turned to ask her another question. It was then that I spotted Scott in the doorway with his phone in his hand. He put his finger to his lips and backed slowly out of the doorway. I wasn't sure how much of this he needed to hear, but I trusted him to do the right thing. Kaz, I bet you had a right laugh at my expense, making me into a cuckold, belittling me. No, Darren, no, we never did that. We both loved you so much. In fact, it was easier if we never talked about you when we met. I told Angus very early on that if ever asked for a comparison of sex with him or with you, he would always fall short, so he never went there again. So Scott was right. This did carry on then. It wasn't just a one-off. Kaz looked at me. Would it make a difference? I shook my head. Yes, it carried on. Though not for a long time. I got pregnant that first time. I felt it. I just knew. They say some women know and I knew. When I came home to you that night and we made love, that felt different too. I properly relaxed and just enjoyed making love with my beautiful husband. I wasn't worrying about making a baby. It had been a long time since we'd made love without that being our ultimate goal. Just loving you, Darren. You're the only man that I've ever loved. I have only ever made love with one man. You. So why carry it on? Was it some sort of training exercise on your part? Well, I had to. We wanted more children, so I had to keep trying with him. When Scott was about 8 months, we met in Leeds. That's where we always met. Never the same place twice. We were careful. Angus could manage to get away then as things had settled down after Jake was born. Leeds was ideal as it was in the middle. About an hour and a half away from home for either of us. As long as we were lucky with the traffic, it was fine. We could get away with it. We did too until you had to mess with that damn family tree DNA rubbish. Don't even think about blaming me for being a slut. I don't deserve any of this. I have done everything I could to make you happy. Haven't I been a good loving husband and a good provider? You've been a wonderful husband, the best. You've been my absolute world, but you couldn't give me the one thing I really wanted, a child. I drew my breath in with shock that she could actually say that out loud. I knew that was what you wanted too, and I found a way to give that to you. Shocked, I just stared at her before starting to slowly clap and give her a round of applause. Oh, well done on your solution. It's interesting then that I haven't got a house full of children, isn't it? The large family we always wanted. We carried on trying until you were 45, didn't we? Then we realized and accepted that it just wasn't going to happen. How long did you carry on trying with Angus? A little bit before we stopped trying. A few months, perhaps. Are you seriously trying to tell me that you carried on having sex with my supposed best friend for a decade? God, I must be the most stupid person in the world. A complete idiot. I've wasted my life. It was all a lie. I collapsed into a nearby chair and Kaz came as if to comfort me. Don't you come anywhere near me. You don't get to touch me. Darren, I love you. You haven't wasted anything. It was all real. How can you say it was a waste? All those wonderful memories, all that happiness. We've brought up a wonderful son together. No, Kaz, we've brought up your wonderful son together. I'm just lucky that he has chosen me to still be his father after all this. I knew now that whatever happens, he would always be my son, blood or not. So, you just went cold turkey from seeing Angus, did you? Gave up all this wonderful illicit sex after a decade. It wasn't like that. As soon as I realized that there was little chance of getting pregnant at that age, I called a halt. It wasn't about the sex. It was never about the sex. I had you for that. We always had a wonderful love life, you know that. Well, it's a vague memory nowadays, Kaz, but I thought it was. It obviously wasn't enough for you. Darren, what I did with him just didn't compare. It just couldn't. It was different. It was separate to us. I won't lie, it did get better. After all, I'd trained him up to do everything I liked. Even then, even at its best, it still didn't compare in any way to you. It couldn't because he wasn't you. Suddenly I was older, I was made redundant, and my new job would make it more difficult to get away with my new hours. I had started to get bored with it all anyway. I accepted that we just had Scott and that was the way it was meant to be. All that driving, for nothing. Sorry that your infidelity had become such a chore for you, Kaz. My heart bleeds. So how did Angus accept it ending? This sex that even when it was bad for you had him in tears because it was so good for him. He had crap sex life with his own wife, but it sounds like he had a bloody marvelous one with mine, doesn't it? You're twisting things, Darren. It wasn't like that. Yes, he liked the sex, of course he did, and he's a man, isn't he? He was really doing it for us, don't you see? For us to have more children. He proved that when I told him it had to end. Yes, he was disappointed, but he accepted that it had to stop. He was sad, but he agreed. So that was it. Yes, apart from one more time. You remember his 50th. He was very down about things. He asked for just one more time. That was different though. I am truly ashamed of that. It felt dirty. I knew I was really being unfaithful that time. I'm truly sorry for that. Just sorry about that one time, his birthday treat. Oh, what's another slice of a cut loaf, Kaz? So how often did you meet during this decade of trying to give me more children? Every few months. 3 or 4 times a year when I was at my most fertile. I paused for a while to think about this. So you've fucked him around 40 times, probably more because you probably did it more than once on occasion. You're making it sound cheap and tawdry. It was Kaz. It was cheap. You made it cheap, like he made you cheap. Did it never strike you as odd that he comes in you twice that first time and his super seed gets you pregnant straight away? Then he fucks you 50 times or so when you are at your most fertile and it never happens again. Well, I presumed that it was me and I never gave up hope that it would work with him or you. Oh, thanks for remembering me in this baby-making bonanza. Yes, I could have still got you pregnant. Maybe it was you. Sadly, Kaz, I have some shocking news for you too. Oh, it doesn't compare with you ripping my whole life apart, but you will find it interesting. Sadly, Kaz, you didn't have any hope of getting pregnant again with Angus. Just before Jake was born, he had a vasectomy. He only told me. I actually took him and picked him up. He begged me not to tell anyone. I actually felt bad about keeping a secret from you. But as I was sure that it didn't affect you in any way, loyalty to my friend took precedence for once. Even Kate didn't know. He knew that it wouldn't sit well with her church beliefs. He was going to have 4 children under 6. He just couldn't risk any more children. No, screamed Kaz. So he wasn't trying to give us any more children. He was merely shagging a willing, stupid BCH. A cheap whore for him then, who only cost the price of a hotel room. I presume he did pay. I bet he got some real internet bargains on those budget rooms too. I mused. I carried on as she flinched. A BCH who thought so little of her marriage vows, so little of the husband who apparently was her world, that she lied and deceived him for 21 years. You killed that love the first time you met him in that hotel room. even before you slept with him. You deceived me, broke the trust between us. What you did after that and carried on doing was pure evil. If that's your idea of love, you can keep it." Kaz looked at me stunned, as if the thought that her finally telling the truth would rid her of any previous wrongdoing and lead to her being forgiven. I couldn't believe that this woman I had loved and respected could be so stupid and have shown so little value to what she had done to me and to our family. "You were unfaithful to me because of what you wanted and needed. You were having your ego fed by someone who thought you were some sort of sex guru. Don't tell me that you carried on to try and get pregnant. I think you got off on the secrecy, the lies, and making a fool out of me. I will never forgive you, Kaz. Never. Get out of my sight. I don't want to look at you." As she turned, she finally saw Scott standing in the doorway. "How much did you hear?" "Enough to know that my mother is a selfish BCH. Scott, please," she whimpered. "No, before you go, you might as well hear this. I've been to see your lover today. I set off very early. I didn't expect to be this long. I didn't think it was fair that he could ruin our family and get away with his being okay. I also wanted to tell him that I would never see him again and make sure that he knew that I had one father and his name was Darren. He seemed a little shocked to see me arriving at breakfast time. He was worried that it was bad news. Well, it was for him. By the way, Mom, Auntie Kate is very anxious to speak to you. She seems quite cross with you." That was before she knew the full story too. "Thankfully, she'll be able to listen to most of your confession to Dad, as I thought it would be wise to record it for her as you spoke. I felt sure that she would want to listen too." Kaz just looked stunned as Scott carried on with his tirade. "At least you were honest eventually. Angus decided to try and lie. Apparently I was made with a syringe and he was only trying to help. No sex involved at all. I told Auntie Kate that I didn't think that was entirely truthful. Ryan seemed the most upset. It turns out she's had a massive crush on me for years, and if I'm honest, I felt the same. Thank goodness we never acted on it. You could have added allowing incest to your sins, Mother." He turned to me then. "Dad, I also took the liberty of hitting your ex-best friend rather hard in the face. Just one hit, but I did it for you, Dad. I knew that you couldn't risk an assault charge and losing your job. I think I'm safe, as he wouldn't dare report me, particularly as I'm sure Aunt Kate did far more damage when she kneed him in the balls." He turned back to his mother. "Are you still here? At least you've got somewhere to sleep tonight. Angus will probably be in a B&B by now." Kate threw him out. "I've given her your address at the flat. I'd expect a visit from her. Update 2. Get past the betrayal. She was always on my team. We were a unit, and it broke my heart to realize that she hadn't been on my side. The sex part of the affair was bad and enough to end us, but what really broke me was the thought of him holding her, stroking her hair, telling her that she was beautiful. The affectionate and intimate moments that I thought were only part of us, which were part of the special magic that only we shared. It was these thoughts that kept me awake at night over the next few weeks as I began to face my new reality. I felt that I would never see myself as good enough again. She chose someone else to give her the precious gift that I was so anxious to give her, but she was too selfish to give me time. I had trusted her with my life, and the loss of that trust had changed me in ways I could never imagine. When I thought about them being together so many times, it made me think how little we had been together in the last few years. Apparently, Kaz had decided that her sex life was finished. She's made that decision that so many others without thinking about my needs or feeling in the scenario. It was a ridiculous thought, but I kept thinking that if her sex life and desire would eventually run out, what a pity she had wasted so much of it on him. It wasn't fair. None of it was fair. I suppose that you are wondering what I did about my erstwhile friend. I didn't do anything for about 6 weeks. I spoke to Kate and even met up when she came over to see me, but I knew that if Angus approached me, I wouldn't be responsible for my actions. He was blocked on everything. I knew that, like me, Kate had filed for divorce. I also knew that none of his children were talking to him. The girls were angry enough, but Jake was the worst. He's only spoken to his father once, and that was to tell him that he wished that I was his father. I'm sure that must have hurt. Good. Each of the children had contacted me in some way to check that I was all right. I was worried about Ryan, as she was taking it the hardest. I think her feelings for Scott were stronger than she made out, and finding out they shared DNA shocked and appalled her. Kate and I had a long talk. She had loved Angus but found him hard work. She told me that she felt like he was another child to look after, and his selfishness at home and private was shocking. She felt he wasn't supportive as a father and only really made an effort when others were around, particularly me and Kaz. We both agreed that they had both done a very good job of fooling us, and neither of us had any inclination that anything was going on. But why should we? We were both faithful spouses, albeit me more happy than her. We trusted them, and that was the main thing. They used our love, trust, and belief in them against us. Kate and I will continue to be friends, and I have to say that she seemed more relaxed without the pressure of Angus. I hoped at this point was that I would always be in her and her children's lives. I did see Angus once more, just before Christmas. I traveled over to see Kate, Jake, and the girls. I needed to see them all face to face and give them my news. I wanted to see Angus for one last time to tell him that I hated him for ruining my life. I wasn't going to listen to his excuses. What was the point? What I didn't expect was the gloating. I had thought he might try and apologize, but no. Perhaps he knew there was no point. Perhaps he blamed me for everything that he had lost. After all, he'd gotten away with it before I uncovered the truth. So I slept with your wife and gave her the one thing she really wanted, a child. I can't change it, there's nothing I can say, and so what's the point? I know you hate me and I don't blame you, but I don't regret it. They reckon that when you lay on your deathbed you regret not having more sex. Well, the only good sex I've ever had was with Cass. Mount that frigid BCH, Kate. No, I didn't love Cass. That was your job, but I did love the sex. I loved how she made me feel. I know I had to lie to her for it to carry on. Even now, alone in this dump, it was worth it. Even hurting you, my oldest pal, was worth it. Knowing that Scott is mine makes it worth it too. When he's finished, I merely showed him my phone. I showed him the message that had pinged in my inbox from the ancestry company the day before. It said that Scott was my son. Quite the best Christmas present I've ever had. I think it was the best present for Scott and Ryan too. Epilogue. 5 years later, my life is so different than I could ever have imagined. Kaz and I divorced, of course. Although I can be in the same room as her now if I have to be, I don't choose to be. We have never had a full conversation since her confession. What would be the point? She tried turning up at school a few times in an effort to see me, but I soon put a stop to that with a brief restraining order. She thought that once I learned that Scott was truly mine, we may have a chance to reconcile. It turns out that she knew me as little as I knew her. We spoke through the solicitors until the divorce was final. I kept the house and Kaz had two of the buy-to-let flats. They added up to the same value of the house and she could have some extra income from the rent of one flat this way. The third flat was going to be sold and we would split the proceeds, but we eventually agreed via the solicitors that we would gift Scott that flat. I think that we were both happy about that. Scott moved into the flat and for a while, whilst Jake was doing his mall locally, he moved in with me as my surrogate son. I didn't do being on my own very well, so I was grateful for his company. Scott and I continue to be very close. He loves his mom and she is still in his life. He might love her, but he doesn't like her very much, I'm afraid. He feels very much that she cheated on him and our family as much as she cheated on me. She lives alone. She claims she hasn't dated. I suppose it's not easy when you don't want to have sex. Maybe she will find someone for companionship eventually, or get a cat. Angus eventually moved to Spain. Ruth is the only child who has been to visit him. She said he is full of self-pity and is drinking far too much. He seems quite bitter about how things have worked out for him. Apparently all that sex wasn't worth it in the end after all. Good. As for me, well, tonight I'm sat around the table with my new wife, my son, and my daughter-in-law. I'm bouncing the most gorgeous granddaughter ever to exist on my lap as we eat. Kate is here too. No, we didn't get together. That would never have happened. She has met someone though, David, but he is away working tonight. He's a great chap and makes her very happy. No, Kate is here, not only because she now has the title of my oldest friend, but also because we share Lucy, our granddaughter. Ryan and Scott married very quietly a couple of years ago. Once they found out that they could be together, they didn't waste any time in admitting their true feelings. They married quietly, partly because that is what they wanted. Also because Ryan is estranged from Angus and refuses to have anything to do with Cass. I'm sorry to admit that this gives me great pleasure. Ryan is fine that Lucy sees her grandma when Scott visits, but she will never be welcome in their home and she will never allow her to look after Lucy alone. The real pleasure in my life is my wife Abigail though. Just when I was at my lowest and had no self-confidence, she swooped in to make me feel better. She was a supply teacher at school, and we just clicked. We fell for each other very quickly, and I soon rediscovered the delights of making love with someone who wants you as much as you want them. We married after 18 months and are very happy. We are loving retirement. Abigail was widowed with no children and consequently thinks the sun rises and sets with little Lucy. She admits that she never thought that she would experience the love of a child and be called Nana. She is so happy that she gets to share in her life. Scott tells me that Kaz is very bitter that Abigail is getting to enjoy her retirement with her husband, her son, and her grandchild. As Scott said, whose fault is that, mother? Certainly not Abigail's, certainly not Dad's, and certainly not mine. You can't argue with that. Thank you for joining us on Revolving Time, where we bring you real life stories that explore the complexities of the human experience. We hope that our stories have provided you with insights, inspiration, and a renewed appreciation for the power of human resilience. We believe that storytelling has the power to create understanding and empathy, and we are committed to continuing to share stories that challenge and expand our understanding of the world. We encourage you to subscribe to our channel and stay connected with our community. By subscribing, you will be the first to know about new stories and events, and you'll have access to a library of inspiring content. Thank you for being a part of our journey, and we look forward to sharing more powerful stories with you in the future.